your mobile phones, your tablets, your computers at all. You are more than welcome to use them gratuitously during this session.
Let's create lots of data.
Yes, let's just do
public data.
A whacking great tsunami wall of data coming out of here.
Excellent.
Very happy to introduce you to my dear friend Neal Stimler. I met Neal originally at a bar, drinking quite heavily in Aarhus, Denmark, believe it or not. Ooh-ah. And as most of us meet our friends, we're just honest about it, right? Realized that we had a common love of art across all dimensions, and was kind enough to accept when we invited him here. We're going to be joined by some of the more interesting folks at the university today. The first being Mr. William Doan, who is with our theater group and gender studies. And he actually knew Neal way back when, but I'll let him talk to that. We've also got Chris Long, James O'Sullivan, Dana Kletchka, Shyam Sundar. Who else is well? Larry Ragan. It's like it's a love-in. It's a digital aesthetics love-in. And we very much welcome all of you to tweet questions. We've got moderators here. We're going to be accepting questions. The first half is actually going to be Neal and Bill chatting with us a bit over three core questions. Our team here from PSU is going to come up and share their points of view. And by the way, just an interest, all of these people were actually selected by Neal, sight unseen. He found them online and said, I really want to come down from New York and meet with these people and chat with these people, which I think is just wonderful. And finally, before I hand it over to you, Bill, I'd like to welcome everybody who is viewing us from another dimension. We are here. We welcome you. Thank you for coming. And with that, Mr. Doan.
Thank you. So I did not meet Neal in a bar because he was an undergraduate and he was under 21 when I met him. So I think I saw him in a few bars, but I didn't really meet him in a bar. But I did indeed meet Neal and develop a terrific relationship with Neal that has now stretched over 10 years. And I'm so proud of what he's accomplished. So let me say that at the outset as a former mentor of his when he was an undergrad. So proud of what he accomplished. We were at Miami of Ohio at the time. I was chair of the theater department at Miami of Ohio when I met Neal. And over the course of his undergraduate education, he came to ask me to mentor and chair his senior thesis because he wanted to do work on Frederick Frank, an artist who I had a personal relationship with and who was a mentor of mine. And so that interestingly, that that project was based on a number of handwritten newsletters that Frederick produced regularly from Pachamon Terrace, where he lived and worked in Warwick, New York. And for Neal and I both, I mean, this was 10 years ago, like the digital thing was a dinosaur. It was in the Stone Ages then, mm-hmm. right? And what we wanted to do was explore the possibility of digitizing this collection of newsletters in terms of, because Frederick insisted on handwriting the newsletter so that everyone who came to Pachamon Terrace, everyone who followed his work would feel that personal connection of this handwritten note every month. And so what we were exploring was what happens when we digitize this collection, can we make it searchable, what are we preserving in the handwriting, how much quality can we preserve. So it was this really sort of early conversation mm-hmm. about digital aesthetics that we didn't even realize. Neal probably realized more of what we were having than I did at the time. So ironically, now he's here, we could probably kick out this project in 48 hours given
yeah.
the advancement of yeah. technology. But it was a great thesis, and it was just a great time for me to get to know Neal and then to watch him leave Miami and go to work for the Met and to accomplish the things that he's accomplished. So I'm thrilled to be here with him and happy to welcome him. So, can we jump right in?
Sure.
Let's jump right in. So Neal, what interests you most about digital aesthetics?
I'm very interested now for institutions like museums to think about the sociocultural and socioeconomic changes that are happening with digital aesthetics. And for me, digital aesthetics is connecting the experience of works of art, but also our sense of the everyday. And so at working at an institution like a museum, I'm surrounded by works that have been told to us as the great experiences of human achievement through art. And of course, those continue to inform me, but I've also seen now with the use of our mobile devices for media making that every person now that has access to a device like this can participate in that making process. And so I'm really interested to see the intersections of when someone comes off the street into a museum building or is interacting with a museum online via Twitter or Facebook or Instagram, how those intersections come together into a whole experience of reality that is their aesthetic experience.
I turned that off. So it wouldn't give us feedback, so I think we're back. Great. I have a couple of follow-ups, but I actually think they'll fall under the second question. So why don't we go to the second question, and then we'll see, maybe I can interject them there. So so what is our fundamental sense of being in the world with the digital and the physical?
So here I'm going to reference my colleague, Stefan Vial, who's a professor at the University of Munich. And he's written and talked about digital monism, which postulates that there's one experience of reality that is both digital and physical. So we're not going to think about the world anymore as virtual or real or online or offline, but one experience of all of these things, because the online experience spills into our offline experiences. The people that I've researched and studied today or connected with on Twitter, like Chris Long, for example, this is the first time I'm meeting him in this space, but we've had a scholarly dialogue on Twitter for some time now. And the same with Shyam Sundar, I found him online, a great talk he gave for PDFs on social media. So all of these connections are coming together into one experience. So I want to point to Stefan's work. Another recent book that's come out is by Luciana Floridi. It's called The Fourth Revolution. And it's about the infosphere, so all of us being surrounded in this information experience. And the key phrase that he offers us there is on life. So he's combined the concept of online with life itself, that they are one and the same. And it's also the idea that information in the machines that are moving around us are informing and directing our life experience. So those are sort of the core ideas I'd want to throw out there for thinking about the unity of the digital and the physical.
In some of this work, and this is a, you haven't had a chance to prepare for this question, so we'll just let everybody know that this is not one of the prepared questions I'm throwing at him right now. But I'm really interested in some of the thoughts that you prepared in your blogs and other things that I've seen you write on your blogs. When you talk about these kinds of the merging of a concept like on life, and there has to be a transition, right? Sort of a liminal space through which we have to pass in order for these to be considered one space, right? And that the technology somehow has to mediate that.
Okay, so here I would want to think about that differently. So I don't really see it as a translation or a transition. I view it as an expansive flux process. So I know that sounds rather spacious, and it's intended to be. So just as the communication we have with one another happens in a continuum, I want to think of it as a continuum. But it's not disconnected. There's not a threshold we have to cross. It's a continual movement that happens. So it's a process that goes back and forth. So just for example, example I like to throw out is thinking about our communications with family members and loved ones. So when we're talking with a chat message service, for example, or doing a video call, I think when we have a relationship with people, we're having an experience of them that is filled with love, is filled with connection, even if it's part of that experience of digital connection. I don't think that they say, oh, this is less than my mother, or this is less than my daughter or son, this is less than my friend, this is my friend. So this is where I want to focus on states of being as an isness, as a presence, focusing on that verb is as the experience, right? When we talk about works of art, when we see an image of the Mona Lisa, typically we don't say that's an image of the Mona Lisa, we say that is the Mona Lisa. We talk about our presence, we talk about our awareness of it.
Okay, thanks. So we'll move to the third question so that we can then set up the panel, right, and get some interaction going. What are the critical aspects of our daily practice with digital technology that foster this life of awareness, this isness that you're talking about, right? Mm-hmm. This life of awareness, beauty, and humanity.
So here I want to point to Bill Ivey, who was the former chairman of the National Endowment for the Arts under Bill Clinton. He's written a book called Arts, Inc. And it's a larger book about the kind of cultural life of America today in response to media being created by businesses. But I think the one key piece that I can take from this book is this term expressive life. And he calls expressive life a gland between the head and the heart, something that contains our heritage and our individual voice. And I think when I realized when I saw that phrase that that's what happens to me when I experience a work of art for a precious moment of my day. For example, I took the bus here from New York yesterday, coming into the valley, and I saw six hawks swooping over the valley, and the afternoon sun filling the gold and green of the valley below. And I felt this pulse within me, and that was my expressive life. Now my awareness to that state, my ability to understand it and to bring it into myself, into my context and my journey, was what I would focus on with Sarah Elizabeth Lewis and aesthetic force. And she references aesthetic force in respect to Frederick Douglass, the great Floratorian abolitionist. He talks about how he had the ability to kind of bring into view an entire experience of awareness that was both with nature, with people among him, and with things that were beautiful. And so what I'm interested in for museums as well is helping us to try to hone these two types of experiences when looking at works of art. So that the most important thing we can help people direct their attention to is how works of art make them feel and live in the world, regardless of what material they exist in and however it's being communicated to us.
Terrific. So why don't we invite the panelists up and continue the conversation. Sound good?
Great.
Well, it's my pleasure to welcome you all here. Neal, especially welcome to the Valley of Hawks. And we were explaining to Neal that every day is like this in State College, 65 degrees, blue and white skies out there. So you're getting it on a really good day.
Thank you.
I feel a little out of place here because I'm amongst a collection of scholars who think a lot about this, but I do get to ask the questions. So I wanted to start with one, if that's okay. And
sure.
Then what we'd like to do is go around and maybe ask each of you to reflect on the questions as well and create an open dialogue so we can share ideas. My question has to do with the, I like the idea of dropping sort of the reference to the real world, quote, and the virtual, and thinking about it as this continuum. I think that's really cool. I think there's a dimension of the physical world, instead of the real world, of tactile and smells and things. And I know technology is quickly advancing that helps us to bridge some of those gaps. I'm wondering if you or the rest of the audience, the panel, might talk to a little bit about the merging of the senses as we move into a space that real becomes defined differently as we go on that continuum.
I think for me right now, I know this for myself as a very visual person, all of those other sense memories for me tend to come in the form of images. So I might have a sense image of a smell or a place or an environment, but for me those tend to live as pictures. I know other learners are very different and that's a different experience for them. Sort of for me, whether it's a still or moving image, I think perhaps my training in art history with print, for example, lends me to think about the world as a picture plane that's moving back and forth. So I tend to always kind of consolidate those experiences.
You see, if I can just follow
Please.
Up, do you see with 3D printing and earlier this morning we were talking about tactile sources of gaining information about a Van Gogh or something like that?
Yes, I think for other learners, there's a lot of potential now with new technology, say 3D printing, to find, or maybe with emulated environments or constructed coded environments, design environments, but there's other ways of exploring that. Many artists and universities have been doing work like this for years, but it's probably been more siloed, but hopefully it can come out to the front. It's something I'm interested in, seeing how it develops, but I'm not sure exactly what it will be for us yet. I think we're sort of early in the game on that. But some museums are paying attention to that. They have started media labs and maker spaces are starting up in museums. These kinds of technologies are going into education departments or education activities in museums. So I think it's something that we'll see more and more.
And Rose, please.
I love the fact that you brought up the sensory perceptions. And one of the things that some of the people here may be familiar with, or anyone who's in psychology, is near and far sensorial experiences. And the far sensorial are the ones that we're highly conscious of, you know, sight, smell, hearing, et cetera. And the near sensorial are the things that are so organically ingrained into us that we're not even conscious of them, you know? And I think we're at an evolutionary pattern right now with these worlds that we're navigating and integrating, where we're moving from very much of that far into near sensorial. And so with a lot of our millennials, we're seeing that kind of tipping point occurring, this next generation down, because they will have grown up with their first toy being an iPhone. They're hardwired into it. It's been there from the 0 to 1 time frame when their neurological patterns are developing. So there will be absolutely no separation in perception this is just an additional sense for them. And we have to kind of recognize that and reflect how we service them in that regard.
Very interesting. We're going to be playing pass the mic today, so just short of throwing, we'll get one to you. Dana?
So another part of the conversation that we had this morning was this notion of not dividing our digital selves and our personal selves. And as an art museum educator, one of the things that I'm most interested in is this notion of how we learn in museums and how we're not just looking at an object and it's not just something that we look at and think about or, you know, want to touch, which is another thing we talked about this morning, but that it's a very social experience, it's a physical experience, there's, you know, a personal context that's involved, and that's something that's been talked about for quite a long time in art museum education based on the work of Falk and Dierking. And I see this sort of digital addition as a way to expand those three contexts. So we have this personal context in terms of the things that we're most interested in and sort of how we go into a museum and what we expect. And the digital world can certainly expand and sort of inform those understandings. But then also for me, it's a great deal about expanding community. You know, we talk about going into museums and looking at works of art and that being the most important thing, sort of understanding about the work of art, you know, X, Y, and Z when we leave. I think for many museum educators, it's almost as much about recognizing what people are bringing in and expanding that that social aspect of the museum and learning from one another in a way that's perhaps different than you had before, but it's absolutely as important and just as meaningful to many people.
I was going to push back a little bit against the monism for a minute.
Please.
Because
I'm having trouble now. The philosopher's got me.
Yeah, right. just because I worry about the elision of difference and the reduction of important distinctions to something that's the same. Mm-hmm. You know, I think with Dana too. I've been working very hard to try to integrate my personal life into my digital life, into my administrative life, my academic life, and to be one person in all of those ways of being in the world. But I am different when I put on a tie and become an associate dean and need to do associate dean kinds of things, and versus when I'm reading a story to my kids or thinking about taking a picture of something in my daily life that's important to me. So there are gradations even within the real world that that are important to hold on to and to think about, which doesn't fragment the self in such a radical way. I'm going to pull it away from my feedback. But so I guess one, and going to the point about sensations and touch, you know, one of my favorite philosophers is Aristotle, and for Aristotle, touch was the originary sense, although the Greeks quickly fell in love with vision, as you are. and vision translates easily into the digital, as does sound. But I think touch undergoes a transformation in a way that's different. Smell, certainly, I don't think we've really gotten there yet through the digital. And so there are differences, and those differences, I think, are important. What I would rather think about is the porous nature of the boundaries between the physical and the digital, and also the recognition that the digital is also physical. There's a physical dimension to the digital too that, you know, somebody like Bruno Latour has emphasized and others. So I worry about what happens when we push too far on the monist side.
I would see the kind of porousness there as the flux process I mentioned when I was talking with Phil. So it is an open expanse, but one of the things I sort of wrote is the finer quoting ideas in the primer there was thinking about that our experience is not limited to. So the material is, for me, as a digital asset specialist, the material is metadata, right? I understand it to be there. It's descriptive. It's informative. It informs my understanding of something, but it's not the essence. And I think that we're still struggling, perhaps as humanists, to remind people to look at the essence, to focus on the essence of ideas and the feelings and the experiences. I don't want that to be lost in what I would see sometimes as an over-focusing on the question of the technology itself.
So I'd like to pick up on what Chris was saying. I mean, I would agree. I think that I mean, the very nature of remediation is such that, you know, I mean, we were discussing before, before the session started, you know, that the people that were with us, you know, electronically were, you know, also present. So they are present, but I think it is different. I mean, it has to be different. I mean, the very, you know, reality of media specifics is that, you know, everything once it's remediated through any, one of many various media is going to be different. And mm-hmm. The second thing that I would say, the thing I would pick up on is that I think where monism gets it wrong is it's not so much a conflation of the self and the digital. Mm-hmm. What we're seeing is a conflation of the self and the interface. Mm-hmm. So our digital, this idea of the digital native, I would completely reject. I mean, 20 years ago, people who were using digital technology knew what digital technology was. They had an inherent understanding that is gone now. I mean, what you have now is, you know, iOS, you have Android. These haven't made us more digitally adept. They've made us less so, because people are interacting with computation through, you know, a very intuitive interface. And I'm not, you know, obviously I see the need for intuitive interfaces, but I think what digital monism gets at is a sort of a conflation that isn't there, quite frankly. And thirdly, just to pick up the idea of on the idea of museums. For me, the great benefit of digital technology in relation to things like remediation in the context of the museum or in relation to digital editions is not that it can add context, but that it can remove context. So, for example, whenever I go to an art gallery, now when it comes to visual art, you know, I'm not your expert, but whenever I see a painting on a wall, whenever I see, or maybe, you know, paintings of fields and whatnot, when I go to a museum, and I'm admiring a piece, I always notice the frame. To give a little anecdote, I mean, I publish a digital journal, and my art editor is always giving out to me because the designer does something that affects the work of the visual artist. So she's like, James, the background can't be gray. Look, you can't put that writing there. It clashes with this foreground. It clashes with this background. What she wants really is just the images with nothing surrounding them, without any context that will affect the, that could potentially affect the reception of the piece. And that, to me, is what's beautiful about. So, you know, when I go to see the Mona Lisa, there is that experience that affects my reception of it based on, you know, the surroundings, the setting, you know, the temperature, what humor I'm in because I've had to queue for ages, you know, to mm-hmm. see the thing. Whereas when I see an image of it, I just see the image. And that to me is the real benefit, that removal of context.
Got another comment over here.
Yeah. On the contextual museum experience that you were talking about earlier, and coincidentally, be, you know, my lab group, and I'm not a humanist, I'm more of a social scientist, we do experiments. And in my lab group, we just published a paper in the International Journal of Human-Computer Interaction about designing an online museum or a virtual museum. And we took that same framework of personal, social, physical context, and we approached it in terms of what can technology do to augment these contexts in a situation, in a space where those contexts might not be as easily kind of available to the museum user, if you will. And so we said customization, the ability to kind of assemble your own artwork, can give you a personal context in a way that perhaps doesn't even exist in a real museum. So in other words, most ordinary museum goers cannot afford to have their own personal collection, but anybody and everybody can do that online and build their own personal collection. And likewise, the tool of interactivity can bring in the social element, the social context that you were talking about. That's the second thing we manipulated. And then the third thing we manipulated was navigability. So they could use a 3D tool to navigate just like it's a museum, real museum. And we wanted to see the effects of, you know, of that and on how they, the user experience of the museum itself. And we generally found that customization gives people a tremendous sense of agency, that they themselves are kind of like curators in a way. They become much more invested in the pieces of art and so forth, and also a sense of control over the artwork. Interactivity was marked with significant increases in perceived reciprocity, or how much they thought the museum was talking to them, and also social presence. They felt that there were others around them appreciating the same piece of art. I think over the years, the museum experience, at least in the American context, has become somewhat lonely. It's not as social as it used to be. These days, even if you go to Asian countries, for example, you do see museums being much more social, in part because of the population and the numbers of people who frequent museums. But here, it tends to be somewhat lonely. And I think online interactivity tools can make people feel the presence of others and co-presence, while, you know, just like social TV viewing has now become common. We can have social museum going. And navigability pretty much was associated with perceived reality. So the more navigable it was, the more 3D tools, the more real they thought this whole museum experience was. So in a way, I would almost argue that the museum, the online experience, the technologically mediated experience, is kind of hyper-personal. You can do more than you can do with in real life. So it tends to transcend what we can do in real life. We can do much more. Like if we are meeting somebody for the first time in a cafe for a date, you cannot find out in an instant, you know, how many friends they have, how many mutual friends they have with you, you know, all of that. But on Facebook, you can get that information within 30 seconds, right? So there are things that you can do online that is much richer than offline. So I don't think we should even hold up the offline world as the gold standard against which we're comparing or, you know.
So along that line, if you will, we were talking a little bit earlier about the idea of how to integrate the technologies. How can we use the technologies to extend an individual's personal experience? So say I'm visiting the library versus not, that we're connected via Facebook. And I'm having an experience viewing, maybe it's a concert, or maybe it's a piece of artwork. How I can now connect into a community where someone might say, well, you know, you ought to look at that piece a little different. Did you notice this? But that's not necessarily something that's going to happen on its own. Do we have a responsibility to help craft that or create that or control that?
I think Dana may have some great answers to that initially, as a museum educator. I have my own thoughts.
We can create another question if that's okay.
Oh yeah, Bill too.
Do you want me to talk while you organize? It's just very interesting because the question of interactivity, there is a new movement in theater called interactive theater, a digital movement in theater called interactive theater. There was an interactive theater movement about 20 years ago that had nothing to do with digital technology, but this notion of an interactive theater has currently been appropriated by those interested in this question of interactivity in the theater. And not just in terms of response, like being able to tweet during, some theaters will now encourage you to tweet during a production, you know, as opposed to turn off the little message at the beginning of every performance that says turn off your cell phones. It's becoming increasingly common for theaters to invite you to leave them on, to tweet at intermission. There are still lots of complications because they don't want you taking any photographs, because if you're in New York and you're in a union house, you're talking about work that's copyright protected, that there are violations of union regulations. So it's a really complicated question about the level of interactivity that can be achieved. But the aesthetic questions around it are fascinating because now there are several online interactive theater companies emerging. Where you can plug in, plug out, become part of it, you know, et cetera. It's also interesting in the sense that theater, live theater, by historically speaking, in order to survive the evolution of film, television, and the digital world, has always insisted that it is the liveness, the body-to-body, being in the space with that body, that separates theater from the other art forms. Not all of us in theater buy that or agree with that. There are those of us who talk about film, television, et cetera, as electronic forms of theater. And so difference, allowing for difference and permeability becomes the key for these things to be in some kind of a dialogue with each other. But for most of us in the live theater, we traffic in bodies, right? I mean, one of my primary collaborators, Alicia Clark Halpin here, is a choreographer and a dancer, and we're just starting to think about how the digital world might become part of how we perform, because we are rooted in the body, the physical body of the actor moving in space, of the dancer moving in space in real time, where audiences can see the sweat flying off of them. If you're in the front row, you're going to get spat on by a well-trained actor is giving off saliva to row three, right? That these things, the body and the embodied experience is so critical to that, that we're just starting to open the doors on these questions of digital interactivity and what the aesthetic implications of that are to our claimed notion of liveness, right?
Thank you for giving me those few moments. That was great. Art museum educators in particular, one of their responsibilities is really cultivating a relationship with communities, sort of understanding what the needs of their particular communities are. As you know, museums are very individualized spaces in different communities that are constructed of, so for example, the University Art Museum is much different than, the Met. So there are different communities that are sort of more present at particular times. And so art museum educators have to be really careful to sort of think about, specifically what they're offering, who they're offering it to, what their goals are with offering, particular programs or educational experiences or engagement experiences. So in fact, yes, I would say that it's our responsibility to think about what technology best matches what we're trying to achieve with any particular thing. But one of the things about that, of course, is that we have to be aware of emerging technologies, and because it's such an expansive field, that can be difficult. So yes, I think it is our responsibility.
Interesting that some of the top technology companies have figured that out, right? And they're like, what do people viscerally connect to more than anything else? Well, the arts, dance, music, visual. And so many of them are now working in collaboration with artists to extend what is possible for art, like the Intel Creators Project. And I invite anybody here to get online, check it out, who are starting to create this new expectation of the museum visitor or the exhibition visitor, that they will become part of the art piece, that they are actually a link to a greater expression of that art piece, and that the technology is essentially just setting it up so that you can enter that realm. And then you, as a visitor, and your cohorts, then take that imagery onto a whole new level. So, with all that technology enables us to do, we have that expectation now, right? I am an author wherever I go. I mean, I'm sitting up here and I'm texting away and all the rest of it. And that's okay, but now that I go into your space, I'm an artist.
Okay, so museums for a very, in the recent past have been very interested in this notion of curating your own experience, and I think there are a lot of digital tools that help us do that. I mean, I think of Pinterest, right? I'm curating my recipes almost nightly. However, so I think that this actually expands beyond that. This becomes more of a social practice. This becomes something where instead of just, sort of curating your own experience, you're making your own experience. And I think this is something a little bit more recent, something a little newer.
I mean, do we want to do that? I mean, are we not interfering with the object of museums, which is the original artwork created by an artist, which is not us?
Okay, but have I now, okay. Have we ever been able to control the reception of a work of art? No, I think you can present it to anybody that you want to present it to. You can do it in a way that builds comparisons between works of art. You can give people particular bits of information before they go in, but when they go in, are they going to think exactly what you hope they're going to think? Almost never.
That's very true. But I worry that we're creating noise when it comes to these experiences. And again, obviously, it comes back to the idea of the frame, does the frame affect the reception of the piece? Does, you know, as you say, the, you know, they're going in there with preconceived notions that they might get from the, you know, the pamphlet at the door and so on and so forth. But, you know, just because there's some noise doesn't mean that we should be creating more.
Sorry. I wonder if that's noise or additional information. So, for example, we are as a culture much more bandwagon oriented now. So we don't buy a thing online without looking at the star ratings, for example. So even our aesthetic appreciation has now a social element to it. So if others like it, then I must like it too, in a way. So maybe we are less individualistic, but it does keep up with the tastes or the aesthetics of the modern times, wherein our aesthetic appreciation is in part determined by what others think. So maybe we're becoming more sheep. Maybe the frame is allowing us to be that way, but that's what the internet and the technologies associated with that is also creating. Should we or should we not? I mean,
should, yeah.
There should be a collective. There's a collective too, right? Yeah. So the collective brings along with it the Arab Spring Revolution on the one hand. The individuals could not achieve the Arab Spring, but collective will can. So there are advantages of the collective that, and in the case of aesthetics, I think there are similar advantages. And the ability to even zoom in on a painting, go very near and be able to see, you know, things, and also the ability to do all kinds of digital sleuthing now has allowed us to uncover, you know, fake art, for example. So these are new kind of affordances, if you will, of the technology that has helped us appreciate and also appreciate real art in ways that are different from what it used to be when it was framed in the traditional way.
As a critical tool, I definitely see the advantage, and I mean, that's my 9 to 5. I use, you know, technology to study art. But what I'm, when you say collective, I'm afraid what I hear is consumption. So,
that introduces my, let me bring this to two experiences I had yesterday in the Philadelphia Museum of Art, because I was in Philly last yesterday, and with my family. Went to brunch at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, and my daughters like to take the elevator. I like to take the stairs, you know, the Fitbit and all. So I got up to the top of the stairs, and
the
wearables
are back in
the
play,
I got to the top of the stairs and was waiting for them to come up to the elevator because that took them longer. And so I thought, well, let me play with this Periscope app that is part of Twitter, and it allows you to bring somebody to go live on the internet where you are. I thought, well, I just got up to the, you know, open to the back door of the Philadelphia Museum of Art. It was a windy day. I was looking over the Schuylkill River. I thought, okay, let me bring the internet here and play with this new app, which I did, and it was very it was great because all of a sudden 65 people were looking at my Periscope from Italy and asking me questions, and what's the temperature and how's this, and I got totally excited about it, and I was, you know, talking, you know, about this and seeing my world differently because I had all of a sudden a whole community of people sort of following along with this. Of course, my family passed me by and went into a brunch, and I got lost, complete track of them. When I sort of pulled myself out of this vortex that I had fallen into, it was, you know, maybe 3-5 minutes later, and I had to start saying, where are you? Where are you guys going? They had already they were sitting down to eat brunch already. So I was somehow, on the one hand, experiencing the world that way with this wide kind of group of people, but missing those moments of time with my family, although we did have a wonderful time at brunch, so I didn't completely miss out. So that's one moment that happened. And the next moment that happened was after brunch, we went, there was a little exhibition of African American art at the Art Museum in Philadelphia right now, and they invite you to take pictures of the pictures and tweet with the hashtag #PhilAMuseum. So of course, what do? I start doing exactly that, and then I start worrying about this. Well, wait a minute. Is there is this kind of marketing dimension to this? There is in all of these, in Periscope, in everything. In Twitter and Facebook and all of this, this marketing component. So, I mean, I think, again, this is part of the affordances and the limitations of all of these technologies and how they bring you into, they amplify experience, but they also can detract from experience. And so all of that is, I think, important. And for me, what's important is to use it to learn what it's doing and how you can do things with it and how it's doing things to you, and it's cultivating certain habits and enhancing experience, detracting from experience. So all of that is I think important to hold in mind, but it's complicated.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's easy for people to say, well, you're just, you know, you're a Luddite or you love technology or, you know, it's really a much more complicated side of it. And I think, you know, that point about consumption, about marketing, about corporate control of some of these modes through which we interact with one another is really important to think about.
Just to pick up on that quickly too, I think that the consumption question can also become a very individual question too, as opposed to sort of a corporate type question. I'm in the process of developing a new play that we recently did a workshop of it in New York City at the Dixon Place Theater, which was a very specifically chosen space for me because of it's a space in New York that's completely dedicated to new work, and it has an incredible reputation. John Leguizamo has launched work out of there. Lily Tomlin has launched work out of there. The Blue Man Group came out of there. So working with Dixon Place was a very specific individual choice for the first time an audience was going to see this play. And now we're going to be performing it in Hershey with a potential partnership with Hershey Medical because of the subject matter of the play. And as we were, I mean, it was very complicated because the play is an autoethnographic thing, and it's about a trauma in my family. And so as, you know, I was actually writing the play as my family was going through this, never knowing whether we should even do this play in public and what would my family, you know. But I started the pre-writing that led to the play was poetry. And I actually started putting the poems on Facebook. I didn't even have the idea of the play yet, so it wasn't a marketing thing, but the response from people to what my family was going through, to what I was going through, and I hesitate to call some of them poems because, you know, they were pretty bad, but they were heartfelt. But as the project developed, it suddenly occurred to me that Facebook and Twitter were ways for me to build an audience for this play when it was going to show in New York, that I still had control over the brand of the show, of what it was all going to look like before I sign a contract with a theater who then becomes, as producer, takes over some of, you know, that authority. So it was a really interesting experiment for me that was riddled with guilt. Should I be doing this? Should I be using Twitter to get people to come and see a play about my sister's severe traumatic brain injury? Should I be doing this on Facebook? It was a moral dilemma, an ethical dilemma, and I had this great creative team with me that helped me talk through that, think through that. So it was now, though, if we get a professional contract, the game changes entirely in terms of social media and digital technology, right?
I think another thing, this sort of subtext or undercurrent that is appearing is this notion of agency and empowerment. So for example, is it noise? Well, people have the right to decide for themselves whether or not it's noise. Or is this, you know, a fancy form of advertising? Well, yes, you know, getting the word out as a way of, you know, letting people know. I'm not sure I would equate it exactly with advertising, but people have the right to decide for themselves how much they want to engage in that and how much they don't want to engage in that. I also realize at the same time, I'm the person that gets really frustrated when people put things up on Facebook that they haven't run by Snopes. Like, I understand that that this is a dangerous proposition in some ways, but in other ways, people have every right to decide for themselves how much or how little they're going to engage in this noise.
And a corporate attempt at social media outreach will be recognized for what it is compared to an individual. And so I think there's that difference in authenticity, which is visible to the consumer at some level. And they have the agency then to kind of decide whether they should reject this kind of social media outreach or, you know, be part of it and so forth.
So if you don't mind, Neal, I'm going to go back to you with this question. So at the Met, because something you said really got me thinking about the personal nature of art and the collective nature of art. And they can be very different experiences. And the collective nature may influence my personal experience. So art, the art for me that speaks most is music. And I've had this conversation with colleagues where I've described it as having a, I don't know if you know anything about fish. This will sound really odd, but bear with me. Fish actually have this longitudinal line in them that help get vibrations and figure out their world. And I've always thought we also have this line in us that is tuned, in my case, maybe to music, and that's how it speaks to me. But it's very, very personal. So when I sit someone down, Bill, listen to this song, listen to this riff, or listen to this, Bill doesn't get it, or may not get it. And what I'm wondering about is, in the museum experience, is there a way that we can provide both, that we can allow it to be the very personal experience where an art piece talks to me or speaks to me, changes the way I see the world or think, and then also maybe be open to the idea that Dana has an observation about that might inform or educate me. So I'm sort of wrestling in my mind with this difference between leave me alone, I want to have this experience, and help inform me.
Yeah. So actually, and this actually goes back to the primer which I posted prior to the symposium today. And one part of it, I use the word individual slash collective. So I see it as both things. I think museums, our role now is to really to be a facilitator, people's personal journeys, and then to offer them the opportunity of other points of view. Another thing I talk about on the primer is, for me, beauty is a very open thing. So I'm not articulating for any one particular type of beauty. It has many forms, many articulations, many gestures, from different cultural experiences, different times, different places. I think my views on that have been greatly informed by being in the midst of an encyclopedic global institution, and as working with colleagues in those types of institutions where I'm confronted by the world at once. I can be looking at a first century torso in ancient Rome, and then I can walk over to the Asian art galleries and see very similar informed styles happening in Sundar at the same time. I can see cross-cultural activity happening. I can see through the history of art people coming together, people sharing ideas, traditions, forms of expression. And so that's, for me, where these kind of issues tend to live, that they're both one and the same. There's an awareness of the modes of those things, but they're still part of the same experience.
So I'm wondering if again, as art curators and thinkers, do we owe it to our students, and students being very broad here, to be able to provide a space for both of those things, and perhaps consider the role of technology in both of those?
Absolutely. There's a great deal of debate right now in my community in museum technology about the social engagement on what we call the object page on a museum collection website, for example. So most museum collection websites right now will provide you what we would call tombstone data, which is like museum lingo. The tombstone data is your board lived, died, it's made of this stuff, it's this big, it's this small, and maybe some bibliography information. And that's great. And then maybe you'll find a label text, which describes from either an interpretative point of view, whether it's be a curator or an educator. But for the most part, the social conversations around works of art digitally are happening outside of that space. There's no place for people on those pages, on that space of dialogue. And so there's a lot of dialogue in the museum community over the last maybe 3 to 5 years about how that should change, how we should bring in that narrative of the personal experience into contact with very specific works of art, which have, within the case of an institution or a body of scholarship, important meaning and standards. So I would hope that as institutions that are excited about engaging with people and helping them find their aesthetic experience in their own lives, that we would be more open to that we would put the emphasis on the openness. That would be the more important. Thank you.
And I would sort of clarify, there are different kinds of curators who work in museums. Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay, good. There are different kind of curators who work in museums. There are objects curators who typically have PhDs in an area that they're, so they know a work of art or an artist or a time period very, very well. And then there are curators of education who do what I do, which is their emphasis and their concern is mostly on the engagement that people have with works of art. I don't care if people walk out knowing people's names or the time period they made something. My concern is whether or not they had some sort of experience with that work that they they recognized something, or they felt something, or it reminded them of something. So really, for me, that social experience is what it's all about. Whether or not they can remember that, you know, Dale Chihuly started producing works of art in 1974 is not my concern. I know, thanks. Great. So yeah, so, you know, that's not my concern. And so I would say that, you know, it depends on who you ask that question in a museum, but if you're asking somebody who is a museum educator, they are very much going to be concerned about what they can be doing to facilitate those conversations.
Can I add something to that? I mean, one of the things that we've seen a lot, especially when we've done research around technology and use of technology, is like not everyone's a creator. Actually, very, very few numbers, 0 to 3%, are like creators online. There's a certain percentage who are sharers. There are some who simply just want more information, and some who want tools. And what we have to be cognizant of is layering of information so that people can self-qualify, so they can navigate in their own regard with their own interests. So a wee bit to the point you were making, James, is, you know, I'm not going to force you into behaviors that are unnatural for you, but I am going to open up this richness of this institution and invite you to eat of the table, as it were. You know, how much do you want to feast? And then dependent upon that, do you want to share that? Do you want to hand it on to a friend, et cetera? Do you want to embed yourself directly into the experience?
But because of the very nature of, and I'm just being provocative here for the sake of it, how do you, because of the very nature of, you know, this, you know, the hive, how do you control that experience? So, I mean, how do you, so you say, you know, there's just richness. Well, how do you keep the information rich? Because once you're, you know, connected to, you know, the web, you know, it's a much harder thing. I mean, it's very easy to control the, well, not very easy, but I would guess it's easier to control the experience of, you know, painting on a wall than it is to control the experience of a more socially connected exhibit that, you know, is based on.
You make a great point, and I think one of the things when Neal and I were chatting, and I have a nasty habit of saying the physical and the virtual. Rose, don't say that. Don't say that. I think we have to give up this concept of control. There is no such animal anymore. And
if there ever was.
I mean, it's kind of like this illusion that we all lived with, that we had control over the experience. But what we're really experiencing, our level of control is how much do we want to give them that is authored by us? How much do we want to enable that is tooled by us? How do we want that associated with us? Versus saying, you know, Dana, like ever I'm going to control anything Dana wants to do in her life. You know, you will only do this, Dana. No, but I can put all this out there so she can say, oh, that was an amazing experience. You know?
Well, and I think that this is sort of a larger context for something else that art museum educators in particular have dealt with for a really long time in terms of interpretation in the museum. There's a really wonderful professor who, his name is Terry Barrett, and he writes about interpretation, and one of the things that he says is, and he very much sort of emphasizes that group interpretations are richer than solo interpretations, and that some interpretations are more informed than others. And he also says that oftentimes groups, I don't want to say self-censor, they self-select the best information. And so that social context, as a matter of fact, and talking with one another helps people to filter out perhaps the less important information. And then also I want to say too, you know, what we're really seeing is this disruption of power that has been held by museums as institutions for a very, very long time in terms of letting people know sort of, you know, what's most important and, you know, what, you know, the information that is most useful for you to know, rather than having someone else present that to you as fact, it gives you some room to sort of interpret it for yourself and think about it for yourself. And I think that that's actually a place that's very scary for some people in terms of what if that information is wrong and, you know, that kind of thing. But you do, you have to let go. There are going to be people who think ridiculous things about everything. So you do have to do the best that you can to make sure that the technology, you know, meets the goals of your engagement plan. But to realize that there are things that just some people are going to find certain things really important and interesting, and other people are just not.
To the world of journalism, and I come from the College of Communications, and we see the same kind of delegation of agency from the a few people who are journalists and the elites, the editors who decide what's news, to now everybody and anybody can broadcast from their YouTube channels and on their blogs and so forth. And so essentially everybody can be a journalist. So at some level, journalism has become crowdsourced. So the concept of source has undergone a sea change in our field, and I think I see a similar kind of tension here. And we can recognize not only the traditional sources who are the experts, so to speak, and then there's the crowd. You know, there's this book called Wisdom of the Crowds, and how the crowd has its wisdom that is better than any one expert or a few experts even. And then there's another third kind of source, which is the technology as a source. So often these days, computers are very adept at trying to figure out, detail. So for example, in your case, I mean, in journalism, there are AI writers. You know, there are computer-generated stories. Similarly, I can see how they could be AI curators. And already museums employ a lot of robots to, as museum, the robots who act as tour guides within museums.
At the Young Museum, they're using the telepresence robot accessibility program.
Right. So the technology is the source. So it's not the curator as a source, it's not the crowd as a source, but it's the technology as a source. And then the fourth kind of source is the user himself or herself, the museum visitor. So at least we have four different kind of layers of sources here. And, you know, any notion of control by the curator is kind of gone out the window when you consider these different, you know, multiplicity of sources that come together. Yeah.
I guess I agree with that, and Michelle's been tweeting about Benjamin over there. So I think Benjamin in the concept of the decay of the aura is pertinent to this conversation. And the fact that what happens when the aura of a work of art does decay means that we interpreters of that work have to step in and begin to be active in our interpretation of it and in our reception of it and in what we do with it together. I want to sort of push the conversation a little bit to the question of performance in terms of performing our own identity and performing the kind of and creating the kind of community around these experiences that we end up doing, because this conversation about control, I think of my own use of technology, particularly with regard to social media technology, as a way of performing myself, as a way of performing my way into the world and creating and cultivating a kind of community. So I'm trying not to put junk out there because I want people's lives to be enriched by the kinds of things I'm putting out there. I don't want to when I take a picture, I try to craft it and frame it and make it something that I care about. Or even when I tweet, I try to check my spelling and check my, you know, whether I've made a typo or not. And I try, and then I try to add value. I try not to just repeat, but I try to add a link to something or to bring something else into it. And part of that is because I hope that people who follow along or join me in this endeavor will also be doing that and will be not just, you know, haphazardly taking, you know, pictures of everything that they see, but are actually trying to curate a little bit so that, you know, we are, not that they're trying to control it so much, but they're, I think of what I'm trying to do as be articulate in these modes of digital communication, learn how to do that, try to teach myself how to do that, and then maybe also as an educator model what that might be for my kids, for my students, for the people I work with. And so, you know, that I think that's an important part of how then control morphs into kind of how we each are performing ourselves online just as we do when we encounter one another in life, in conversation, you know, face-to-face conversations, and in our different modes of interaction.
So can I ask you a question in response to Chris's reflection about process? So I think one of the things that probably I learned from being in the theater with you and through osmosis is about demonstrating process, about showing, even though that exposes oneself, right, that exposes one's sense of self, that exposes one's humanness, which I think that we probably worked through together with Frederick's material as well, Frederick Frank, the artist that you mentioned earlier. I think drawing is a process that exposes human process and human frailty, whether it's towards a sense of finish or unfinish. But I think you can speak to a lot about the openness of process and how that comes to a wholeness in some way.
Wow, that's a huge question. And I think, you know, all artists that I know and work with have a different take on that too, right? Sort of process product relationship and where they place the value and how they place that value, whether it's in terms of an education process or a training process or their own creative process. But I'm also really interested in what Chris was saying too about the, you know, about performing identity and how that, you know, relates to this question, because the, so for example, I mean, we're all always performing identity, right? I mean, whether it's gendered or, you know, whatever it happens to be. You know, for example, I made a very specific choice today to have my sleeves down and have a jacket on because I'm covered with tattoos, and I identify mostly as a solo performance artist and a playwright, but I have also, I'm finishing my third book with a Hebrew scholar that we look at the oral traditions of the transition from the oral traditions of the Hebrew Bible to the written traditions of the Hebrew Bible performatively. But most of my work is rooted in solo performance that deals with class and masculinity. And my most recent solo show was called Confessions of a Class Straddler, in the ways in which I have learned to hide the fact that I came from a very poor farm family, that I said things like cement and guitar, and I dropped the F-bomb all the time, and I grew up on Vienna sausages and, you know, Little Debbie snack cakes. And so this question of performing identity is really interesting, and in fact, most often from members of my family and people I went to high school with who encounter me on Facebook, they think I'm an asshole because I have abandoned my class identity on Facebook because of wanting to curate a certain way on Facebook, wanting to promote myself, perform myself a certain way on Facebook. I often go home and encounter a lot of resistance and frustration from people I grew up with. You know, I have a PhD. My brother calls me a peckerhead deluxe. That's what PhD stands for, right? And you know, he's probably right. You know, and or I have behaved that way, I'm sure, at certain times. So the complexity of this notion of how we perform in this space is fascinating to me. The ways in which we can perform in this space. And then coming back to the process question, I'm intrigued by that because for me as an artist, when I'm working on solo material or even my play, you know, the workshop in New York, the process is what most engages me. You know, the way, what are the things influencing the work? What are the forces influencing the work? From the fact that we got a review in Theater Wire, you know, and all this, and it was a good review. Right? I wouldn't have read it if it was a bad review. Someone would have said, don't read that review, and I wouldn't have. But, you know, you use the good review to fuel your own, you know, ego and your own. But that process, the ways in which this question of performing oneself and the process of how you create, why you create, what you create, are probably what I'm most immersed in right now with these questions. Does that answer me?
I also feel like digital technology enables us to have some sort of entree into that process. You know, just by looking at some, you know, just by watching your play, you may not quite understand all of these decisions and what went into the creation, but there are ways to provide information for people to get, you know, some sort of personal look at that.
Aside, Richard Keeley was here at the symposium recently, and he talked about people and how they learn, and how he's from Cornell, and he was saying that, you know, it's not enough that we just relay this information to all of you, that you actually need to then, you know, ask questions of yourselves, contextualize it, put it into practice, etc. And I think that the digital is taking on a lot of that onus, right? For those of us who's, you know, when we were kids, the end of the street used to be our boundary, right? Now it's our front door. So where do we get to explore? Where do we get to test these things out and repeat them the six required times to actually fully understand them? You know, this has become our new playground in many ways, where we can express these things differently. And so it's part of our processing. It's a critical part of our processing, the processing of our children.
Yeah, and I mean, this to me is the real value of technology, is the creative potential for it. So I mean, a lot of my work, I study electronic literature, which is, you know, literary art, but it has an inherent, you know, computational component. So, you know, it's the kind of literature that, that does things aesthetically that you cannot do without a computer. And again, it's this idea of, I mean, I would say, not always, but in a lot of respects, the process is more important than the product. I've done a lot of criticism where I've argued that what the author is doing that's significant isn't what they produce at the end, but it's this sort of perverse engineering where they take some type of platform and they manipulate it for you know, some artistic purpose in a way that you couldn't do without technology. Yeah, to me, process is very significant.
Larry, should we turn it over to the audience? Or
that would be, let's see what we have. I'll run the mic around.
Mm-hmm.
So questions, Chris?
I work in the education technology space. I've been working on a project with Dana to integrate technology into the Palmer Museum. And I agree that we're probably deluding ourselves that we can control people's experience through technology. But I'm also keenly aware in designing this technology with her that there's design decisions that I can make in the way that I build the technology, the way the technology functions in books. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering the extent to which, and we've had lots of conversations about making the technology minimal so that we're not affecting the visitor's experience too much, and that it's really about the artwork that they're enjoying. But I'm wondering, in general, in the technologies that are out there, to what extent the technology designers are doing a good job of sort of getting out of the way with the technology and letting people be creative in themselves, or to what extent, I mean, there's, in Facebook, there's a certain way that you interact with each other, because Facebook made decisions about the way that they designed the technology. Are technology designers doing a good job or not?
Well, this is the key thing where I was getting at with control is, I mean, we can say that, you know, or, you know, this technology does this and technology does that, but technology does what the designers designed it to do. So it's, by the time we take it out of the box, a certain set of, you know, interactions will already be predetermined. But what's, I think, a very positive thing is the fact that as curators, you're not just curating the works that are being displayed through this technology, you're curating the technologies that you use for that process. So there is at least that, you know, mechanism to ensure that, you know, the technology we use is suitable to the...
Yeah, one of the things that my adoption of technology has taught me, and partly, Chris, through thinking about instructional design, but is the importance of design in everything. And so, I mean, not only the design of the physical pieces of technology used, but the design of the software and that interface and experience. But what I've also learned in thinking about design is that it's never a unilateral process. It's always a dialogue, at least, between the designer and the users that are interacting with it. And you know, I can't imagine that the people who designed Twitter, let's say, you know, had anticipated that it was going to be, you know, morph into the kind of thing it was, and then that, you know, things like hashtags and other kinds of things would take off. So that's part of the point about the control question. You know, we think, I mean, I think people who design technologies, you know, have sometimes the illusion that they're in control of the experience or in control of the technology that they're putting out there, and only to learn that there's a whole lot more possible than they thought, or a whole lot more damaging,
you know, than they ever thought because of some specific decision. And one of the things that I'm trying to think more about, and I need to learn more about, you know, the programming and algorithms and those sorts of things, are the way those things are acting on us. They become opaque to us. The way, you know, the way you Facebook is delivering, you know, things to my feed, it's changing all the time. It's opaque. And so figuring out how to use it, I need to learn more about how it's using me, you know, but that's opaque because they need to use it to market. So I mean, just to take one example. So, I mean, it's a really complicated dynamic.
The dynamic might be by invoking the concept of affordances. You know, Gibson, a perceptual psychologist, introduced this idea where it is halfway. You know, there are stimuli in the environment, and so in the design world, especially in human-computer interaction, it's I think an understood principle of thinking about technology and the interfaces as kind of affordances, and what they are essentially are action possibilities. And so the users can either take it or leave it, and it can intrude or, you know, not let it intrude. And so in a way, the examples that you brought up, like Facebook or Google for that matter, some of the best examples of most successful technologies are examples of interfaces that do not come in the way at all. Google is simplicity, you know, personified, right? I mean, Google is the simplest interface that you can think of. So is Twitter, so is Facebook. You know, it's just a simple text field where you can say what you want within some character limit of 140 characters. So in that sense, design can take a little bit of a backseat, but it is an affordance that the user can, you know, decide whether they can make use of it fully or not.
So I'm Herbert, creative director here, and this is a fascinating conversation. This is a personal comment and then a question to it. When I go to a museum or, you know, see art, hear music, any of that, it's always a personal experience, right? And at the same time, I'm part of a larger audience. Some may like it, some may not like it at all, and depending on that, they may then communicate. So it's first my own personal experience, the next level is who is part of it, and the third level is who hears about it. But then there's another very interesting level that especially in a museum hits me every time I go, which is the context of time. So right now, this is modern, this meaning fill in the blanks. 500 years ago, something else was very modern and some people hated it, right? And 1,000 years ago, it was very different. So suddenly it puts me into the context of time, and I may understand that what I just now dig really deep may be gone tomorrow and nobody cares. So the museum also has that very interesting aspect of putting me into the context of the time, usually looking backwards, but maybe at some point we can also look forward, which will be very interesting. So my question is, I was just Googling now, digital museum jobs, and a whole host of stuff came up. So we are not talking academically here. This is actually happening, right? Am I right here?
Yeah, absolutely. So first I want to bring up the kind of reflection upon the museum and time. So once upon a time in museums, photography was not art. Photography could never be art because it was reproducible media. Now we have entire museum departments, entire curatorial areas of practice that focus on photography as a medium and digital as a medium. So this is a change to remember as well, back from tomorrow we're going to be talking about Goya, talking about prints, talking about images in multiple, images that can be understood as a text, images that can be understood separated as individual images, images that are seen in a group, and how that changes at the time. So I think that's a very interesting fact as well. But in terms of the museum sector of technologists that are playing a role, I think having someone like James here is really important because I see myself as a digital humanist. So I am a humanist. I am someone who was trained in the humanities as a scholar, but who found interest and opportunity in helping new constituencies by exploring the power of individual technology. And as we're talking about design and aesthetics, while a certain designer may be influencing my experience of the embodied technology of a wearable watch, for example, like the Moto 360, part of the design aesthetic experience I'm encountering is the fact that I'm putting this on my body. It's part of my movement. It's part of my physical interface of the world. So I accept and I'm open to that design intervention. I choose to accept it. I, as a user, check the yes box of the terms and conditions. So I'm opting in because I'm fascinated by it, and it's beautiful to me. Right now I have an app on my watch and on my phone and on my tablet called Musée, which is by a Russian developer who's taken images from Wikimedia Commons, publishes them to me every day as a new wallpaper, a live wallpaper from all my devices synced at the same time, and links out to where that image is from and information about it. So every day I have that, and I also have another app called Daily Art, which is a really interesting app that publishes, and I think it's available for both iOS and Android. I get notifications on my watch every day on my phone, and I get a new work of art automatically served to me. So it might be, there might be this element of control, but it's also the content that I choose to be part of my life. So I choose this content to be part of my life experience, and I want more museums to participate in that process. So here again, how do we do that? I think openness is the key. Openness with our data, openness with our collections, with our digital assets, to make it possible for creators and developers and those interested to engage this content to be able to build these types of design experiences for us to have in the world, so that in addition to having commercial content from advertisers, which is a part of our world, it also becomes art and museum collections at some point as well, depending on who that person is or how their work is received, that all of this exists together, and that we allow for that personal and that communal journey to help navigate between that process.
I also wanted to say something really quickly, because I keep thinking we're moving in this direction, and Herbert, I thought you were going to get to what I'm thinking, but almost, but not quite, is that I think one of the things that we're sort of talking around a bit is age at this point. I think that a lot of the way that people conceive of technology has to do with their own, of course, experiences with technology, and the assumption that the younger you are, the more native you are, or, you know, the more of a digital native you are, which I think in some ways is, well, it's not, I think it's incorrect, but I also think it's an assumption that is kind of damaging. There's this assumption that there's a certain generation that feels like this sort of solo contemplative experience in art museums is sort of what you've expected. And it seems to me that there is a prejudice against technology in museums, because it's assumed that the only people who really want that in there are these young people who can't put their iPhones down. And so I think that there's this sort of unspoken prejudice against technology. I'm one of those people. So I think there's this sort of unspoken prejudice against it, because it's considered to be something that won't be around, it won't be lasting, it won't make an impact that will continue, which I think it already has. But I think, you know, that's something we haven't really talked about a great deal. They're really, and when you're, you know, Googling the digital technology jobs, and that's something that's also quite recent as well. So for some people, this just isn't necessarily part of their radar. The expectation or the assumption is that the younger you are, the more open you are to it.
So I just want to pick up on that point about openness. I mean, for me, I mean, I'm a big advocate of open source, open access, and all this. But the issue I have is that when we say openness, we apply that to the content that we're curating and putting and disseminating. But the tools that we use are not open at all. So, for example, you know, Twitter. If Twitter shut down tomorrow, all the stuff we put on Twitter would be gone. Yet we still use Twitter. You know, by the company who were, you know, so, you know.
Library of Congress supposedly is archiving.
I mean,
it.
And you can, but we've had trouble getting access to tweets that you have to pay it for. I mean, Twitter is, and how, you know, how does Twitter work? You know, I mean, it's a business. I mean, you know, all the information that Google has, you know, on its servers. Google shut down tomorrow, which is highly unlikely. All that is gone.
I think there's an expectation around, there should be a cognizant expectation around that, how that functions. I think the museum or the archive of the library can play a role in archiving and preserving some of that. But also this is part of living, that as living entities, as living people in this process, some of these things come back to us in different forms. And so we accept that, and we continue to move, we continue to keep walking.
Why not strive towards open platforms as well as open content?
I think that'd be great if we can do both. I think the role of the museum so much is not to, at least in the immediate term, is not to necessarily to maybe develop its own separate platforms, which can't scale, which can't really build across boundaries, but it's to make, museums have, we have the stuff historically, right? We have the stuff and the information about the stuff. So I'm much more interested in giving the greatest opportunity and the freedom for other people to make that work, whether they choose to develop their own platform or use another platform. It's making that essential content available.
There's another thing that kind of crops up from what you were just talking about, James, which is in the idea of openness. We so many times think in this world in very, very literal forms and in a state of perfection, which Chris, in some ways, when you asked your question, we have to kind of let go of perfection in this new world. Things are changing so quickly now that we cannot be slow enough to create perfection. We have to create for elasticity and change and evolving. And I think, you know, it's anathema sometimes to academies especially, where we are the foundational groundstones of knowledge, right? It should be known, it should be defined. But right now, the consumer, the user, is evolving so quickly with regards to what they're expecting as the norm, that we're never going to achieve perfection. Let go. You know, it just make sure that you can keep up with the stream and where they're at.
Just the question of the audience, too. There's a really interesting field of study in the performing arts now, audience reception theory, that's specifically related to performing arts, dance, music, and theater. It's a quickly sort of evolving field based on the way they collect data, who's, you know, and the different methods that are being worked with. Authors like Marco de Morenes, who wrote a really important article called Dramaturgy of the Spectator, which talks about how the event is created by the spectator, whether they're sitting in a theater, sitting in a concert hall, the ways in which the event is created by the spectator. And then Susan Bennett, who was one of the foremost theorists on audience reception theory. But they look at this relationship between open and closed communities as one of the places that they start, and then sort of what happens to an audience, or from our perspective in the theater, what happens to the spectator and their transition from their own subjectivity, their sense of who they are as an individual, to the ways in which they give up to a communal, give in to a communal experience, and how that happens. And even on the sort of commercial level of things, I mean, over time, the way a play starts has been specifically sort of evolved around some of these notions, you know, of when, like, the first thing that happens is the house lights go to half, because you gather in the theater and everybody's talking, and they're, you know, some theaters let you take the drink in from the bar. The commercial theater in particular is fueled by alcohol sales. You know, and then they're, you know, let you be part of this communal gab fest, and then the house lights go to half, and you hear the audience get really quiet, because they've been trained now that then the next thing is the blackout, then there's a blackout for 3 or 4 seconds, the next thing you know you're going to see are the curtain, the lights come up, the curtains open, or whatever happens. And, you know, all of these things come from these notions of who is the audience, who is the spectator, what's happening to the spectator. But the more interesting questions are about sort of what the changes are that a spectator goes through and experiences as part of the event, and the ways in which then their presence creates the event itself. Great stuff.
Very good. Thank you. I'm going to ask Lillian to channel for us a question from our guest online.
We've had several questions that are related to the notion of curation, mm-hmm. and the root of that, this notion of care. And one of the questions I'd like to bring up, which is more sort of thinking out loud for this particular participant, but there are several related threads. Ruminating on what care really entails for the digital in the context of 21st century is a worthwhile discussion. Mm-hmm. And so we've talked a lot about sort of those blended spaces. And I think particularly the other thing that's coming up in this is this notion of the limitations to you know, what we're caring for, or how we're interacting with that. Mm-hmm. So, and I'll look for some other specific instances. But if the group of you would be willing to speak to the audience on the notion of care,
I guess, I mean, I'd like to start off just kind of frame that a little bit, but. As much as I care about museum collections, and I do care a great deal about that, I care most about people's experiences of works of art and how they feel and how they exist as human beings in the world. And so that is the primary focus that I have when asking questions about digital aesthetics. And for me, I found personally growing up as well in my contemporary life that works of art throughout history and time are the way that I access that experience and information. So that's the point of view that I care about digital aesthetics and curation. So for me, the care is the preservation of the object as a source, and artifact of information, of experience, of expression. But the next thing I care about is when I turn to the person next to me, I turn to the tweet or the Instagram post, how it is received and experienced by another person I'm communicating and sharing with.
And in fact, I would argue that what we're doing as educators or, you know, curators of education in museums is that's part of our role, is to determine, you know, how we are going to care and how we're going, what we're going to put forward as the best way to work with that particular thing or with a particular group. It seems to me just to be an extension of the work that we're already doing.
Yeah, I appreciate that question, partly because I think there's a tendency not to care. At least I experience it a lot mediated by technology. And, you know, I'm really sensitive to the way words and images have a power to transform our relationships with one another. Mm-hmm. And those, you know, caring words can be so enriching to our lives. Caring and careful images and gestures can be really ways in which we deepen our relationships with one another and the world we encounter. And so often I see the desire to be flippant or to be funny in a surface kind of way or to be snarky or to be clever as the sort of initial response to things in the online world. So I mean, you know, and part of this is I have two little kids and two little girls, and they're figuring out what it means to be online. And they're also learning about the power of words in all those contexts, in face-to-face contexts and digitally mediated contexts. And so thinking as I just had a conversation with my soon-to-be 11-year-old about, you know, I'm not putting something on Facebook or on Twitter or online that I wouldn't say directly to somebody and be ready to deal with the consequences of what that means. And so, I mean, I've really thought a lot about, is this, when I press this button, send, tweet, whatever, is it going to enrich the world or is it going to impoverish the world? Mm-hmm. And so I think at the core, that's what I'm thinking about when I'm thinking about curation, when I'm thinking about care. It's about the community that's receiving it and the world that is created by it. And that's, I think, at the core of what I think of creation, of curation as. On creation, maybe that's a good Freudian slip right there.
Yeah. There you go.
In terms of moving things online and into the, you know, online world like the museum, online museum and so forth, what we should care about if we are thinking about technology are the affordances of the technology. And in general, I think of four main classes of affordances. In fact, I call them main. Main stands for modality, agency, interactivity, and navigability. I think these are the four things that we should care about. And modality is really what, at the core of a lot of our experiences, how things have become multimodal, have become more visual. In fact, the internet's taking a visual turn now. And, you know, it used to be primarily textual. And so that has a profound implication for all kinds of online experiences that we are, you know, trying to kind of translate from offline to online. Agency is this idea that the user has control, and there are other agents other than just professional experts who are trained in that discipline. There's collective agency, there's self-agency, there's computer agency. interactivity, of course, we all know is about, you know, how we can interact with the tools as well as with others through those tools. And navigability is the ease with which we navigate this. In fact, even though I'm a professor of communication and psychology, I have a joint affiliate appointment in architecture because I was involved in helping them design an online immersive virtual environment where now communication is now an interior design concern. You know, we have to now design spaces, not just put pictures up online. It's not shovelware as we used to call them. So I feel like navigability is again a kind of a design imperative. So really we should be caring about these four things: modality, agency, interactivity, and navigability.
I think modality is a really important theme that you've addressed. And this is, as I would say, the same is true for works of art. If we happen to be in the physical museum, that is one mode. If we're looking at an image on our phone or on a wearable display or a heads-up display, that's another mode. All of those, I would say, are connected experiences. I would emphasize those, that connectivity between them, understanding there are differences. But then the thing that I'm most interested in pursuing is, what does the essence of that expression mean? What is that work of art? What is its aesthetic force? What is its expressive life, me as a person being in this world?
Right. And also how you might negotiate that in the multiple modalities.
Exactly. What are the...
For example, Google Art Project brings together artworks from your museum and several other museums.
Right.
And so there's that kind of dual experience that people now have the privilege of experiencing. And so how does that shape their overall experience of art? Yeah.
So, but we also have to look at this question of modality really broadly too, right? In terms of class, gender, accessibility, race, ethnicity. I mean, because that, you know, I think the assumption that that effective modality can be achieved without a deep consideration of why, in the first place, people would want to even engage that piece of art or what, you know, what that art might represent to them in terms of a personal or a class history or whatever, you know, at some point that really complicated conversation has to happen too, right?
Right. Very textual. Now it's taken a big visual turn, which brings in a lot of the people who have literacy issues, which, you know, goes a long way in kind of bridging the digital divide. So yes, the race and class issues are kind of embedded in this seemingly technological issue.
I like thinking of this as embedded metadata, which is a very interesting way of approaching it. It's part of the asset or the experience of the media that moves forward.
But yeah, I'm very recently struck by how complicated this issue because of KDR and the incident on our own campus of images showing up in a private Facebook page. You know, I mean, this is a, the degree to which this is a complicated question about power representation is, you know, stretches way beyond the technology questions. I mean, the human questions here to me are so deep and so complex, and they don't seem to me to be keeping pace with the technology question.
Very good. I've got another question here, if you don't mind.
Thank you all. I'm delighted to be here. Obviously, I'm a senior citizen, retired architect. I understand all the communication and the evaluation that's going on in the discussion. I'm very concerned when we talk about the arts as to how the digital age is distorting, through use of my word, perception of individually created artwork, how it is becoming almost impossible for me to look at things on screen and appreciate what the creator was in terms of his ability, as it's been redefined by putting the technological cover over it. And in your museum, are you acquiring original works of art? How is that hand-eye coordination of individual productivity being influenced by what we're doing? I mean, there's a young lady who's doing an amazing sketch right here, hand eye, and I'm not hearing anything.
Keep going.
About
it's a modality.
How that is a part of the content.
Sure. I mean, yes, museums continue to acquire works of art in many media. Some of them made by hand, right? It could be a drawing, could be a painting, could be a sculpture. Some of them are animated GIF files, they're little moving graphic interface images. Some of them are pieces of code designed by an artist whose material was a computer and software. So some of them are performances. So I think if we're aware and mindful of the artist as a person, as a creator, which I think is probably what it seems to me like what's most important to you, right? The presence of the artist, the impact of the artist as a creator is transmitted or shared with us. We can do that through documentation of artists, by the video interviews, by their correspondence, whether that's a tweet or a letter. The artist's presence with us also comes in the form of the work of art that they make. So I think it's a sensitivity to all of those things. I don't think the digital technology has perhaps changed things as dramatically. We've had photography and film for over 100 years, and that probably for some people was the real change in terms of a big shift. But these all become tools that artists use to express and make their world in a conversation with one another.
A wonderful example that I invite you to look at online, which is the 21st Century Hotel. And that was a very wealthy family in Louisville, Kentucky, went to the Louisville Museum and said, we have a lot of money. We're the wealthiest family in this town. We want to build a wing for the living artist. And the Louisville, Kentucky Museum said, well, we'll get right back to you on that. And they came back X amount of weeks later and they said, you know, great idea. We'll take your money, absolutely, but we want it to be about like 19th century French painters. And give us your money. And the family turned away from them and created a hotel. Because they said, people don't really go to Louisville to see art. They come here to drink bourbon and do all these other things. So let's make this hotel a museum, which is genius. But I think would not have been as possible in other generations. But is giving an enormous outlet to living artists who create things by hand in a variety of different modalities, photographers, digital artists, even their television station at the hotel is video artists, which is phenomenal. And they actually were voted the number one hotel of their price range in the world, the only US one to make that ranking. And now they're spreading out all over the place. So I think the artist is alive and well and getting far more traction now than maybe they previously did.
I think it's a question of balance. So my home institution, University College Cork, a couple of years ago purchased a book called The Great Book of Ireland, which is a one-of-a-kind book which was put together in the 80s and 90s and includes writings by, I mean, all of Ireland's, you know, great canonical writers, you know, Beckett, and they're all in there, alongside some visual interpretations of the pieces, and it's hand bound and you know Sardinian goat skin, and it's an absolutely beautiful work. And while I was happy to see that, you know, they paid $1 million for this book, which is a lot of money to an Irish university. And while I was happy to see that they pursued this for the purposes of preserving this original piece of art, it still hasn't been digitized. So I'm guessing I'm the only person in this room who has seen that. So it's a balance between having that original, you know, beautiful artifact and access to that. And I think it's, what I was going to ask the two of you, you know, based on all of this discussion, and based on, you know, some of these, you know, this need to strike this balance and some of the things we're talking about in terms of, you know, care and curation, mm-hmm. How has that changed your professional roles in terms of your actual day-to-day in terms of what you do as curators?
Well, so I started out being very, very concerned as a graduate student. I was very concerned about what people would know by the time they left the museum. I wanted to give them factual information. I wanted to make sure they had everything that they needed to make a factual interpretation about a work of art when they left. And my thinking in the almost 20 years that I've been in museums has changed, obviously, quite dramatically. I want to go back to your question just really quickly. I think it's interesting that you bring that up. I don't feel like anything that I'm doing has to do with whether or not an artist, I guess I don't feel like it has anything to do with whether or not I recognize or am supportive of what artists do. I think this notion of the eye in the hand versus artist's ideas is something that has been coming, you know, into the forefront for a long time in terms of art schools talking about what's really important to be teaching our students. And for me, I'm working with an object that's finished. I'm really interested in the way it was created, and I think that digital means are a great way to help explain that and give context to it. But as far as I'm concerned, I'm not part of that process necessarily. So it's interesting to bring that up. It's not that I don't value it, and I think that we can put some more value on that by explaining it more and giving people that information, but by the time it reaches me, it's sort of done. However, I also feel like this has, you know, everything to do with access. When you were talking about, I still feel like my goal is to get people into the museum space so that they can see the brushstrokes. So that they can see with their own eyes or have that experience with their own people. But I realize and I recognize that there are a great many people who are unable to be there in person and to get that information. And so for me, it's a question of levels of access.
I would say the work that I do is really helping to digitize and figure out how to design workflows for digitizing museum collections on as large a scale as possible, as quickly as possible, most efficiently as possible. So my interest growing up in Northeast Ohio, I was very fortunate to have parents who loved museums and loved the theater and loved classical music and loved jazz. And so their life process brought me to those institutions. I know there are many people that never have access, again, as Danny was pointing out, to that opportunity, and so the love affair really can't start, but it has for me, and so my mission is to make art accessible or humanistic content, really more broadly, could be literature as well, to as many people as possible before I die. and to do that with a way that is also supporting and preserving the institutions where I encountered that, but I wouldn't actually say that my intent is to necessarily always draw them to the physical institution. But it's to bring back that notion of care. It's to care for them where I can reach them in that moment.
And one of the things we talked about this morning, we had a meeting previously, is that according to the National Endowment for the Arts, too many NEAs, they have documented actually that the attendance at concerts and plays and orchestra performances and museums is down quite significantly in the past 10 years or so. And what they mean is that in person, that attendance is down. And some of the reasons that they cited for this are some people have young children, and anybody who's ever been with young children know how they can sort of put the kibosh on plans, or somebody gets sick, or somebody's not interested. Another reason that people cited was being alone, not having anybody to go with, or they're unable to go to these places when they're open or accessible. For example, somebody works during the day, which many of us do, and museums are open during the day, when do you go? So those are some of the things that they had been talking about in terms of physical presence. And while that's something that I value tremendously, I wonder what the result would have been if they had also looked at how many people were engaging with these things digitally. Because one of the things that they even mentioned is, and I should put a copyright on this because eventually it's going to come back.
Or you could be open. You could be open about it too.
Okay. Yes, I can.
You could put a creative comment license.
I'm going to put a CC on this. So I call this the Netflixization of culture, right? So we are attending these things or bringing these things into our lives when we have enough time, when we have the ability, when we have those 20 minutes. We download the concert. We bring up the work of art that we're interested in on Google Art. So really, I think what we're doing is a very logical response to the changes in society, And that we have to continue to engage in this in order to serve our audiences in a way that they are demanding to be served.
And this really picks up on several things that have been said, but I really want to focus and hear from you. Bill Doan, you particularly talked about those that aren't part of, I would say not part of the digital aesthetic. And I'm thinking about a participatory digital culture, and particularly the notion that the content is skewed, I would say the aesthetics are skewed by who is participating. I was thinking, Herbert, when you were talking about those levels, my thought was, what about the level of those that aren't there, you're not hearing from? You know, you talked about, that's really where I'd like to kind of focus the conversation. I also want to, Neal, you had mentioned about your the commons of Wikipedia, mm-hmm. and what a wonderful resource or fun thing that comes up on there. And we know, for whatever reason, and the reasons are debated, that only 10% of the content is by women on there. So I'm thinking again about, you know, the agency that you talked about, and you know, it's been a touchdown, but I'd really like to focus in on how, particularly strategies that you're thinking of, that or examples that bring in a digital aesthetics from those that aren't really part of that participatory digital culture, for all these reasons: gender, race, economics, abilities, all sorts of things. Thank you.
I'll just jump in real quick, in the sense that as an artist, I spend most of my time thinking about who has not seen my work, right? Because they seriously outnumber the people that have seen my work. And so I imagine that there might be some real value to thinking about that, but I think about it in very specific ways. I think most solo performers do, people that exist on the fringe in a variety of arts areas do. But even with this new play of mine, thinking about how I want to usher it into the world, do I want it to go into the professional world, or am I looking for a route where there'll be a larger audience that the impact might be greater on? So I spend a whole lot of time thinking about who doesn't have access to the work, whether it's in a digital participatory way or in a live participatory way. And that remains the probably the biggest motivator for me in my own artistic practice. Coming from a family where I'm the only artist. I mean, how old is my family? You know, hundreds and hundreds of years, whatever. I'm the first artist that anybody can trace in my family, you know. I was one of those kids who never had access to the arts when I was growing up, till my mother put me into a Catholic school where some donor had rented a bus and bought a symphony ticket. And so, you know, all the little poor farm kids got bused down to the Cincinnati Symphony, and it was transformative. It was powerful, you know, that symphony experience for me, but it was so class regulated, and I've sort of never, that's still a huge part of my baggage. That is my big question. And what are the ways? So my strategies are, as a solo performer, as a playwright, as an artist, I look for opportunities where I can go into communities and build community engagement first, build partnership first. Even the theater work I did around fracking the last 3 years with that NSF group, going out into communities, trying to create community engagement first, get the community to feel some ownership of the work, so that when you bring the work in, it has a different feel to it. So for me, that's kind of the strategy question.
It occurs to me that your question really has everything to do with the sort of institution to which we belong to right now. This, what is the role of the 21st century land-grant institution of higher education? It has to be about making accessible these kinds of experiences to a wider variety of people, just as originally institutions like this reached out to farming communities and to wider swaths of citizens to bring liberal and practical arts to them. It's really incumbent upon us in the 21st century to be much more intentional and much more successful than we've been in bringing more diverse people into the higher education experience, more sensitivity to issues of gender, issues of race, and diversity, not just as something we speak about as an ideal, but as something that we live out in our relationships with one another and in specific strategies to make our community here and at Penn State and in other higher education institutions more diverse, and to help learn together what the affordances and limitations of these digital modes of interaction and communication are. But I think that that's incumbent in a particular way upon us as members of land-grant institutions, that we have to really embrace and do a much better job addressing in a very serious way. And I'm glad to see that we're starting to try to think even more about that at Penn State. But you know, we've been thinking about it. We need to really find the strategies that work and put those into practice.
Yeah, I just wanted to address this issue of agency a little bit in terms of how we can strategize in terms of the technology. So the idea of, when I said agency as an affordance, we're looking at a whole suite of agency enhancement tools that not only allow average individual user to you know, do the Netflix thing, which we, by the way, in our field, we call that time shifting affordance. Mm. DVRs are time shifting technologies. So like that, we have you know, technologies that allow for individuals to experience works of art in isolation without the pressures of class and race surroundings. On the other hand, we also have technologies that will allow for community support. So one of the things that has happened is the YouTubeization, if you will, mm-hmm. of art, which is, you know, average people can make their own works of art and put it out there, and then they have a huge following. And so in study after study, we see that this the support for the external validation that you get for your work of art or whatever it is that you put up online is tremendously agency enhancing, that people feel that there's a sense of, you know, there's a big following, there's a community following, and also the, you know, number of Twitter followers you have, that's also an affordance. You know, so anybody and everybody can get up and go with regard to, you know, participating in this digital milieu that was previously kind of had restrictions that were class and race based.
I would also add that I think what we're discussing here is also different layers of access. Art museum educators are very conscientious about the communities that they serve, and you know, thinking about the communities which we don't serve or could serve better is always a part of what we do. So I just think of this as a process of layering, in terms of this is one possibility for reaching out to communities who are underserved in some way or the other. For example, at our museum, we also have a busing system where we reimburse people who are from particular areas of the community, well, actually all over the community, but more if they're from more rural community areas. But also in terms of the kinds of engagement that we create, thinking of particular audiences as we're strategizing, I guess, our programming. So this to me is just another layer in sort of a large arsenal of things that we have at our disposal in order to engage the broadest number of people possible.
To answer the question sort of about Wikipedia and the technology there too, is I think one of the things museums can do is make the content and the data accessible, right? So it's easier to tell your story about your community of practice and your experience when you have the data and the content to make something, to tell people about it, to tell a story, to build something. So this is, again, where I would encourage museums to open access to their data and their content so that we can have a story of a Native American ceramic, we can have a story of an African power figure, we can have a story of a woman basket maker or a painter or a sculptor. If we give people the tools to help tell their stories and make those accessible on broader platforms, I think we'll have a better chance of having those voices be part of the conversation. So that, to me, is where I think we can play the most acute role at that. Of course, there are people that are doing great work within the Wikipedia community, at the Grand Wiki community, addressing issues of race and gender. That needs to continue. But again, it's hard for them to make something if we don't support the process. And that means inviting them in for edit-a-thons, which many museums have done very successfully. So it means having those specific events, but it also means to give people the raw materials to bring together the story about Lee Krasner, who's an amazing painter, but isn't often as much acknowledged as her husband Jackson Pollock.
So just quickly, too, there's really and also a very interesting geographical framework for this as well. So for example, a higher percentage of people go to theater in Chicago than they do in most other major cities in the U.S., and it's because Chicago has a history of having neighborhood theater communities. There are these professional non-equity theaters in almost every neighborhood in Chicago, and they develop their loyal fan base, and people go to the theater all the time. Broadway, right? Everybody thinks our gold standard in the theater is Broadway, and it's not. Maybe for the musical it is. And Broadway's had banner years the last 3 years in a row in terms of attendance, which is crazy because the average Broadway ticket is up over $200, okay? So you know who's going, right? So they've had banner years in terms of attendance, but the attendance represents less than 2% of the population. The fact is most of the people that see theater or hear a concert do it at the local high school where they are still able to, right? So if, let's say, 60% of people across America, and particularly in the Midwest, are experiencing the arts as it's being created by their children as opposed to professionally, there's a story that we need to really be paying attention to here that just fascinates.
It seems to me that we need to get together again in about 1 year, Rose, because although you attempted to solve all of the world's problems, we still have a few more. First of all, I really want to thank you for getting us to think deeply about these topics, and thanks to Rose and Neal as a stimulus for this discussion and dialogue. Thank you for each to what you bring to us. Can you join me in acknowledging our group? So we're not done yet. That is, we've got more conversation going on tomorrow. And does someone want to say a word or two about that?
Sure. Yes, I encourage you all to join us at the Palmer Museum of Art tomorrow. We're going to be having a great workshop. I'm really happy to be joined by Patrick McGrady, who's the curator there, Henry Pisota, the art librarian, and Andy Schultz, who's our Goya expert. We're going to be going first to talk about reflectively our own practice with prints, sort of in a lightning talk format, but more of a reflective way, just our experience of prints and visuality. And then in part two, we're going to be interrogating, looking at one particular image, just one image that is the focus of our attention. It's plate 29 from Goya's Los Caprichos. There's also an exhibition at the Palmer Museum right now of the whole series. We're going to focus on one plate. We're going to look at the plate. We're going to look at it on Google Glass. We're going to look at it on the Moto 360. We're going to look at it as a text on a tablet, and we're going to project it all at the same time. So we're going to have all the modes to experience at once, and then we're going to see how we feel about it and dialogue about it together and learn and push our boundaries and see what we can do by this. Because oftentimes I think these questions are placed in silos, right? The interpretation is happening in one aspect here and another aspect here. So let's bring it all together in one room, focus on one amazing artist, Goya, and see how it impacts us tomorrow.
Terrific, thank you. And I think you said all the modes. So
yes,
I heard
all
that
the modes. Vanilla, Rocky Road, no.
All the modes.
Incredible social media moderator. Yeah, I think, you know, we've gotten a lot of really wonderful feedback, and this really is a great demonstration of what we're doing. It's actually quite social and quite successful.
Yes, and tomorrow we will also ask you to bring your devices charged, ready to go for yet another round.
Very good, and thank you all for your participation as well.
Thank you, everybody.
Good afternoon.